Greg, trying to get a sense of where the crisis could be heading, we're joined now by Elizabeth Obeigas, Syrian analyst at the Institute for the Study of War in Washington, and from London, journalist Mina Al-Oraibi. Thanks so much for being with us both. Mina Al-Oraibi, I wonder if we could start with you. This is described as what's going to be a limited intervention with limited goals and limited international support. Does it make sense?
It actually doesn't make sense. It makes sense politically in the wake of the Iraq War. 10 years on, there is no appetite for a full-blown invasion or any boots on the ground. So this emphasis on it being a limited strike and a punishment, which is a word that we keep hearing from Washington, London, and other Western capitals, that there needs to be punishment for chemical weapons. And yet the killing goes on. Yes, the use of chemical weapons is something that has to be condemned and cannot be allowed to happen again. But at the same time, 100,000 Syrians have been killed, if not more, and millions have been displaced in over 2.5 years. If anything, if we can say the word good, the good that's come out of this is to actually force Syria on the agenda. There needs to be some wholehearted efforts to come to a real diplomatic solution that forces the killing to stop in Syria.
I'm going to jump in on that. Elizabeth Obeigi, one theme that seems to emerge is that for the U.S. administration, this isn't really about Syria. This is about chemical weapons. Can you separate the two?
I think in this case, you really can't separate the two. And at this point, our options for action are looking more at maintaining U.S. credibility and the president's kind of harsh rhetoric on the use of chemical weapons, rather than on the very complex situation that's unfolding in Syria right now.
Well, I want to ask you more about that, because the president's rhetoric is the chemical weapons were a red line. This John Kerry talked about this being a moral obscenity. The principle here is very, very clear. But in practice, this is going to mean bombing real places, potentially killing real people, and having a real impact. And I'll just give you and our viewers a sense of what they have in mind. The target list obviously is secret. It's not been shared with us, but the kinds of targets that we're being told about include places like the Presidential Palace, the Ministry of Defense, the National Broadcasting Center, which is where state television is broadcast from, Syrian military intelligence, Syria's government headquarters building, which has been the target of rebel attacks in the past. These are obvious targets for the rebels. They're obvious targets for the United States. If the principle is to punish and deter the use of chemical weapons, is anyone even going to remember this list in 10 years' time if the war continues? Is the goal here fundamentally flawed because nobody will recall this when the history of this war is written?
I think the real problem is that there's really nothing we can do to stem this. The use of chemical weapons from afar at this point. So any action that we're looking at is going to be a punitive measure. It's going to be meant as kind of a slap on the wrist, as been mentioned. But what that means is that we're really lacking a more comprehensive strategy that addresses the roots of the conflict here and in ways that could actually be more negative than positive and could have some very dire consequences.
Mina Al-Oraibi, one of the questions here is why the Syrian government would have done this. The British intelligence review concluded that they couldn't figure it out. Does anyone in the region have any idea, or is there still widespread skepticism that Bashar al-Assad is to blame?
There are lots of questions about why they would use the chemical weapons, especially at the time when the chemical weapons inspectors from the UN had arrived in Damascus. And really, the Syrian regime was able to buy time. So the use then, while you have the chemical weapons inspectors in Damascus, didn't really make any sense. Having said that, there's so much that defies logic in what's happened in Syria. This entire conflict could have been saved had the regime actually taken the peaceful protests that were happening in Syria in a way that could have avoided all this bloodshed. So to be honest, logic in itself is not enough to make us understand why they would act in this way. Having said that, the British have also said that there were, and again, based on UN reports, there were up to 14 different uses of chemical weapons in Syria. There are those that would question if some of the rogue opposition elements or some of the militant opposition elements could have used the chemical weapons. Again, we don't know. The White House assessment that came out today really doesn't, or the declassified assessment, let me say, of the chemical weapons use in Syria doesn't really answer any of those questions.
There is another question, and I'm going to ask you both to stay with us while we listen to a brief excerpt of Secretary Kerry's remarks today describing the alliance that the United States is hoping for. Let's listen.
The Arab League pledged, quote, to hold the Syrian regime fully responsible for this crime, The Organization for Islamic Cooperation condemned the regime and said we needed, quote, to hold the Syrian government legally and morally accountable for this heinous crime. Turkey said, there is no doubt that the regime is responsible. Our oldest ally, the French, said the regime, quote, committed this vile action.
And I think we have the front page of the New York Post, which speaks very eloquently to this in a much more iconic way. The British aren't coming. Instead of the British are coming, the British are coming, the British aren't coming. I'm wondering, Elizabeth Obeigi, when we hear Secretary Kerry describe all of these organizations that may be somewhat uncomfortable with him citing their support, organizations that may subsequently back out of whatever project the U.S. undertakes, is the Syrian regime taking comfort from the fact that even Washington's closest ally doesn't want to be involved?
I think that's absolutely correct. And if you look at this, the real issue here is there's just not the political will behind any sort of action. And what that means is we're looking at these kind of half measures and small steps that really don't look at this, again, as a comprehensive strategy. And to that degree, the Assad regime, Syrian government, and its allies are really sitting back and are able to continue doing what they want to do, regardless of any consequences or actions that could significantly stop kind of their current calculus.
Now, I'm inclined to believe Secretary Kerry and President Obama when they say this is not regime change. I'm just wondering if either of you think that this may go the way of the Libya intervention with a dictator being toppled at the end of it. Do you, either of you have a thought on that?
We've already made it clear that regime change is our goal. We've kind of have emphasized the need for President Bashar al-Assad to step down, and we've provided support, both non-lethal and military assistance, to the opposition. So I'm unsure as to why now we're backing down from this regime change as our ultimate political objective.
Mina Al-Oraibi?
Well, I think it's not the stated objective of this mission, if it does go ahead. However, it's clear from the list of targets that you referred to and many others have referred to that it is to weaken the regime also. And there have been many in Washington, Senator McCain and others, who have said we have to try to tip the balance so it helps the opposition to, as some people here say, get the job done and actually turn over the regime. I don't think it will happen that way. Libya was different in many ways. And again, Libya had the UN backing. And so it was a longer military campaign than I think anything we can see happening for Syria.
Elizabeth Obeigi, you study Syrian extremist groups, and groups we would call extremist groups are in the forefront now of the opposition to the regime, among them al-Nusra, an al-Qaeda offshoot. Is the United States unwittingly going to be helping the very people it most fears in Syria, even more than Bashar al-Assad? Is it unwittingly going to be helping the jihadists who would love to take control of that country and might end up doing it if Bashar al-Assad falls?
To be clear, I actually researched the opposition, which is only kind of a small minority of which includes extremist groups. They're still very much kind of a moderate opposition force that the U.S. government has in the past looked to support and should actually expand its support for. That being said, I think that any sort of half measures, as I mentioned before, could significantly have an inverse impact and actually radicalize the opposition in favor of the extremist groups rather than its current strategy.
Mina Al-Oraibi, let me ask you just one last question, the key question. When these strikes come and when they're over, are we still going to be talking about the civil war in Syria? Are we still going to be mourning the innocent dead there?
Well, I think many of us will be talking. However, it will likely no longer dominate the headlines, and it will no longer put the same pressure that we're seeing at the moment for governments around the world to act. Importantly, I think it also has to cast a light on what role the UN is playing today. The Security Council has shown yet again that the current veto system gives power to a few countries who can determine the fate of the rest of the countries.
Mina Al-Oraibi and Elizabeth Obeigi, thanks so much for talking with us.